very supportive of the gym and Common Society. So I'd like to pass you over to Steve Pryle, who will give the annual Tommy Grimes Memorial Lecture.
Thank you very much, Alan. It's an honour to be invited to give by the Jim Connell Society to give this Tommy Grimes Memorial Lecture here in the county of my birth, and that of Jim Connell too. Alan Grimes, the chair, who sent the invitation, said that Anne Grimes, Tommy's wife, was pleased that I had accepted the invitation, given my part with Tommy in helping to get the wonderful monument across Kiel done and unveiled 20 years ago in 1998. I speak as one who holds formal offices in the UK and Irish Labour movements. I'm a member of the GMB, Unite and the British Labour Party. I'm a delegate to Battersea and Wandsworth Trades Union Council, which was set up in 1894 by a contemporary of Jim Connell, which is John Burns, in southwest London. I serve on the executive committee of BWTUC. I'm the founding chair of the management committee of BWTUC Trading, the fundraising arm of BWTUC, with well-known brands such as the Workers' Beer Company, which runs bars at festivals, Ethical Threads, and our own Bread and Roses pub in Clapham in London. I also serve on the Irish committee of the Workers' Beer Company. In this latter capacity, I am delighted to say that BWTUC accepted a recommendation from the Irish Committee last autumn to donate €10,000 to the abortion rights campaign to prepare for the forthcoming referendum. Until the end of February 2016, for 11 years, I was the National Press Officer for the GMB Union with nearly 640,000 members, and I did nearly 2 years on and off for the RMT, for Bob Crowe. So I'm well used, accustomed to making statements and addresses in public, but always in my official capacity as speaking for these organisations' policies and positions. To be asked to give the Tommy Grimes Lecture, for me, is a departure. I'm being asked to speak for myself. This means that I have to take responsibility for what I say and be ready for the vigorous debate and disagreements that are necessary and essential for open and honest discussion in our movement. I want to take from my lecture a number of themes. First, the words of the red flag itself. Second, the rural background of the man who wrote it. Third, the achievements of our own founder, John Burns. Fourth, how history gets rewritten and why people like Tommy Grimes have had to rescue parts of it. Fifth, some words on the last 40 years of BWTUC. And finally, from these themes, to come to some conclusions from what we should learn from this long history and how that points us to the future. Of course, given the breadth of this history, I can only scratch the surface. Let me start with Tommy Grimes and the monument to Jim Connell in Cross Keel. What is it about? The song, The Red Flag, with its rousing chorus about raising the scarlet standard high, became the anthem of the newly unionized and highly politicized manual working classes and set out their aim of never giving up, to bear it onwards till we fall, on the struggle for economic and social justice. The message in the song is clear in describing a struggle that goes on without let up for generations. It is clear that the struggle involved prisons, come dungeons dark, as per the Tall Puddle Martyrs, and are martyred dead, like those killed at Peterloo in Manchester, whose heart's blood dyed its every fold. The struggle is international too, with the French, Germans, Russians, and Americans actually name-checked in the second verse. It underlines the powerful employer hostility to trade unions and those who seek to haul the sacred emblem down. Because the man who wrote the song had lots of practical experience of this hostility in action, but it is hopeful too, of peace at last and human rights. It was written by a man from rural County Meath, born not far from here, in 1852, nearly 170 years ago. Like many of the rural Irish at the time, he ended up in London. I will come back to this because it is an important lesson for our own day. He wrote the song in London in 1889. That year and 1888 are very important because they were the watershed years in the history of the manual working classes and their long struggle for combination. That is, their ability to combine into unions and force employers to bargain with them collectively. There were three breakthrough battles, all in East London. First was the Match Girls strike on the 2nd of July 1888 at Bryant and May and Bow, which involved 1,400 women on strike. And the issues they were on strike about was a lot of issues. They were being asked to work 14 hours a day. There was fines, arbitrary fines. Their strike leaders was dismissed, etc. The strike forced the employers to deal with the appalling working conditions that were giving rise to injury and damage to health on an appalling scale. So it was a victory. Second were the workers at the Beckton Gasworks, which was the biggest gasworks in London and the world. It supplied gas from coal for the whole of the city and the West End. At the gasworks, they worked around the clock with two 12-hour shifts for 6 days on, 6 days with one day off. On Sunday, they met on the Sunday, the 31st of March, in the open air in Canning Town, and formed themselves there and then into the Gas and General Workers Union. They put forward one demand. Bearing in mind they weren't recognised, there was none of that sort of stuff. They just put forward one demand. They demanded an 8-hour day. They wanted 3 8-hour shifts without loss of pay. They threatened a strike, and the employers panicked because it was a cold winter, and they conceded the 8-hour day, which was an amazing breakthrough. Third, in June, inspired by the gas workers, the dockers in London, who were the zero-hour contract workers of their day. They were casual workers, the zero-hour workers of their day. They demanded proper jobs and a pay rise of 6 old pennies an hour. Among their leaders was John Burns, who, as I said earlier, set up BWTC. This was another huge success. On the back of three successes, general unionism among unskilled workers and semi-skilled workers spread like wildfire across the UK, which then included Ireland. In 1891, the second largest branch of the Gas and General Workers Union was in Dublin, and the second Congress of the Union was held there. The Red Flag song celebrates the victories of the Match Girls, the gas workers, and the dockers in London where Connell lived, and where he himself had been a dock worker. I know that the Jim Connell Society invited Rachel Holmes, the biographer of Eleanor Marx, to give the first Tommy Grimes lecture. Eleanor Marx, with Will Thorne, played a fundamental role in the Gas and General Workers Union and the spread of new unionism across workplaces involving men and women. Eleanor, at the Dublin Conference, successfully moved the motion that men and women should be paid the same rates for the same job, something that was opposed by the older craft unions. The spirit of hope in the song turned out to be fully justified. The generation of leaders that led these battles and the growth of new unionism, they went on to form the Labour Party, and Sean mentioned it earlier, in 1900. The movement made steady incremental progress over the next 70 years, even in the face of war and the Great Depression. Our John Burns in Battersea won control of the newly established council in the 1890s. The forerunner of BWTUC built homes for rent, set up a municipal electricity supply station, opened public baths and laundries, and because food adulteration was a real problem, they set up a food standards body in the town hall, and they also set up the first electoral register that was set up anyplace. Their slogan was, get rid of the middlemen, so they replaced the contractors and directly employed the workforce. John Burns was the second ever Labour MP to be elected to the House of Commons. In 1907, as a member of the UK Cabinet, he put on the statute book the law that enabled councils to build houses for rent, and the Fair Wages Resolution, guaranteeing workers fair pay when doing work funded by the taxpayer, whether employed directly or by a contractor. Both bits of law stood until Mrs. Thatcher repealed them in the 1980s. He resigned from the cabinet in July 1914, refusing to sanction the Great War, which he correctly forecast would lead to pointless killing on an industrial scale. The list of achievements of the labour movement set up by these pioneers and their successors are so numerous and have endured to such an extent that they are now taken for granted. The NHS, the education system, the welfare state, democracy and the rule of law, economic and social justice. The movement outlawed discrimination, legislated for equal pay, built millions of homes for rent, nationalised the natural monopolies and created the national parks and the greenbelt. As the T-shirt for an American union says, unions, the folks that brought you the weekend. At BWTUC, we remember John Burns with pride. That's why we celebrate the Red Flag Festival and have been a supporter from the start of the Jim Connell Society. What Tommy Grimes achieved in erecting the Red Flag Monument in Crossachaile is of enormous importance, and I will tell you why. I grew up in County Meath, and I never heard of Jim Connell or the Red Flag or its connection to our county, and that was the case for the vast majority of people. Jim Connell and the Red Flag were simply written out of history. I said it would come back to Jim Connell himself, and why, like so many others from rural Ireland, they ended up in England and Scotland. There was a number of different factors at play, so I could only give the briefest of outlines of the complex changes that led to the massive exodus of people from rural Ireland and into the cities during Jim Connell's day. Let me spell out the extent of the movement that I'm talking about. The census return for County Meath in 1841 was that there was 183,828 people. 183,828. The census in 1911 shows there was a population of less than 70,000. Now if you look at the actual specifics, between 1841 and 1851, the population dropped by 43,480, and it is estimated that of that, 20,000 of them died in the famine. At the end of the 1851 census, the population of Meath was down to 141,000. But what happened in the next 50 years was the census for 1901 showed a decline of a further 73,188, i.e. 52%. Now what happened in County Meath was not exceptional. Jim Connell was part of the decline. So he was part of it. As you can see, the terrible potato famine in the 1840s gave rise to the horrific devastation and hunger, and the population fell by 43,000. But something even bigger in economic terms was happening. The free trade movement in the United Kingdom succeeded in abolishing the Corn Laws, and they swept away the restrictions on the import of cattle from Ireland, which had been in place since Tudor times. While there was a ban on the import of cattle, the Irish rural population had grown rapidly to over 8 million people, and their main export was pigs to England, which had to be fed by potatoes grown on small holdings. These mainly small tenant farmers were known as cottiers, and I would imagine to the academics they would call them peasants. The result of the change the changes as a result of the repeal of the Corn Law meant it was now more profitable for farms to be given over to cattle, and the people were cleared out. As the census shows, more than 70,000 left between 1851 and 1901. In the history of Meath that was published, it was a multi-chapter history of Meath was published in 2015, and it's a big book. And there's a chapter on this story, and in that chapter it said, William Bufflin, on his cycling tour of Ireland in 1902-03, described Meath as, quote, a lovely wilderness of grass, a verdant, fertile desert from which man had banished himself and into which he had sent the beast to take his place. It was a land given over to the bullock. Annual live cattle exports from Ireland rose from an average of 200,000 a year in 1846 to 50 to over 800,000 a year before World War I. In the cows area where Jim Connells came from, the population round here dropped from 29,382 in 1851 to 13,271 in 1911, a decline of 55%. Another important factor in the story is that when Jim Connell was born, most of the land of Ireland was owned by 10,000 mainly Anglo-Irish landlords, many of which were absentees, whose only connection with Ireland was collecting the rents from the tenant farmers. The tenants had no security of tenure, and rents could be increased at will. There was constant agitation for security of tenure and resistance to evictions. There were secret societies, and it was pretty rough stuff. The land league was mainly led by small farmers in the West. In 1870, the Gladstone government introduced the first Land Act, which provided security of tenure. So like a game of musical chairs, when the music stopped, whichever sitting tenant was in possession could sit on the land. This favoured the cattle farmers, who were gradually taking over the tenancies. There was a series of Land Acts, the last of which transferred the ownership to the sitting tenants. The economic historians have since gone over the land registries, county by county, and they have established that 20,000 native Irish families ended up with half the land of Ireland. They got some 10 million acres between them. For those who want to read about the political consequence of this transfer of ownership of land from the 10,000 Anglo-Irish families to these 20,000 native Irish families, I would recommend that you read a work by Raymond Crotty, Ireland in Crisis, which is out of print, but the Meath County Library does have a copy. Crotty said that the result was that Ireland became a fat cat society. And he said it had more golf courses and more race courses per square a mile than any other nation in the world. And we ended up with the green flag and ruled by the Catholic Church, and the population continued to decline by emigration. You may not agree with Crotty on this, but one thing you can't disagree with is that Jim Connell and the red flag were written out of history. So the achievements of Tommy Grimes in reclaiming this important history, which links the decline of the rural population with the rise and success of the labour movement in the cities, is huge. The two are linked, and that's really important. The children of County Meath and Ireland owe a debt to gratitude to Tommy Grimes for this. I did say that I would talk about BWTC itself over the last 40 years. In 1979, Mrs. Thatcher came to power in the UK. She set about reversing many of the achievements of John Burns and his successors. As I mentioned already, she repealed John Burns' council homes for rent and began the sale of council houses. She abolished the fair wages resolutions and brought contractors and outsourcing all across the public sector on lower paying conditions. She went after the trade unions, and in particular the strong unions like the miners and the dockers. She shackled the ability of the unions legally to fight back. Her economic policy led to the migration of long-standing industries like clothing and textile and footwear and engineering to countries like China and other parts of the developing world, where labour costs are 10% or less than those in the UK. The jobs of nearly half the unionised workforce migrated overseas, and the trade union membership halved. Unemployment soared to 3 million. It was the beginning of the process, what we now call globalisation. In Wandsworth, all the factories along the River Thames and the River Wandle closed down one by one, and at the same time, much of the public sector workforce was outsourced and privatised. For the trade unions in Wandsworth, these changes threatened their very survival. For BWT itself, the choice was change or die. I don't have time to describe in detail how BWTC itself came to the decision to set up in 1985 a fundraising arm called the Workers' Beer Company. We made the decision to raise funds to ensure the survival of BWTC itself, and to gear up the trade union movement in Wandsworth to unionise the industries of the future and to restore trade unionism to the private outsourced sectors. We have done the last bit, and it's a constant battle. And we have survived, and in fact we're one of the few trades councils in London that have. We choose to get involved in the music industry, running bars and co-promoting events. We developed the model whereby the labour movement campaigns and bodies could volunteer to work where their wages were donated back to their organisations. Due to the enormous hard work of countless volunteers working unpaid on the management committee and on site, the organisation was a success and did generate funds for BWT itself and many other parts of the labour movement. There is pressure for this story to be properly documented and written up, and maybe one day it will be. There is a short film on BWTUC website to mark the 30th anniversary of trading if you want to know more. I would now like to tell the story here about how the connection to Tommy Grimes came about and the links to BWTUC and GMB London region. It was these links that were instrumental in getting the monument off the ground. Somehow, in the 1990s, my brother David, who is a linesman in County Meath, found out the connection between Jim Connell and Keld, and he told me. You have to remember that in those days there was no internet. I found out by my other brother Paddy, living in Navan, that there was a Tommy Grimes who was a Labour councillor in Keld, and that he had heard that Tommy was trying to get a monument off the ground of Jim Connell. I was aware of the link between John Burns and Jim Connell and the Red Flag because of the dock strike. I was also a close friend of Paul Kenny, who was the GB Regional Secretary, in whose region the Gas and General Workers Union had been formed. I spoke to Paul Kenny, and he suggested we try and make contact and set up a meeting with Tommy Grimes to establish what he was proposing. We did that. The very first meeting between us was held in an hotel in Sussex near Gatwick Airport. Tommy Grimes and Michael Allen, who was the chair of the Urban District Council, were on their way to Lewisham for an event to mark Jim Connell, and Paul Kenny was on his way to Brighton for a meeting, and that was where their paths crossed, so that's where we set up the first meeting. At the meeting, Tommy said that his idea was for a monument in Kilskea to Jim Connell. Things moved briskly. Paul Kenny said at the meeting, there and then, that GMB would donate 20,000 towards the Red Flag Monument linked to the memory of the gas workers and the 8-hour day. I said I would go back to the BWTUC committees to ask for a donation of 10,000 from us because of the links with John Burns. Then Paul Kenny made it clear at the meeting that as far as he was concerned, it was essential that whatever form the monument took and where it was placed, etc., was solely a matter for people on the ground in Kells. And then Tommy invited Paul and myself to travel to Ireland for the St. Patrick's Day parade in 1997 and to meet the committee that Tommy had set up to take the monument on board. This was a very productive trip, and it was there that we learned that the plans were well underway for a monument to be unveiled on May Day 1998. On reflection, I am filled with admiration for the tireless ambition and organisation of Tommy Grimes, who in a short time between October 1996 and April 98 realised and built the wonderful monument that is now in Cross Achill. I think it is very fitting that tomorrow a chair dedicated to Tommy's memory will be unveiled at the monument. Now, just as a little aside, there is a picture in the book. This was the book that was put out at the time of the thing. And the picture in the book shows me and Paul Kenny and Tommy outside the school at Kilskea, yeah? And that's where we were going to put the monument, outside the place there that was where the old pump used to be, yeah? Anyhow, Tommy, as I said, a tireless work by Tommy, he phoned up Paul Kenny and he said the woman who actually owned the ground had got very attached to the tree that was overhanging, yeah? And that basically, if the GMB could see their way to give her £2,000, she might actually sort of... And Tommy basically said, under no circumstances would she give her a penny. So he went down to Cross Achill and actually on the common land and put the monument on the common land. Now that was Tommy, and yeah. So But, you know, I think, you know, if what Tommy achieved in those 2 short years, but then he had a vision, and fair play to him. Now, as I said, the monument and the song remind us that these gains of the Labour movement didn't come out of the sky. They had to be fought for, and they have to be defended. The monument comes from a conscious decision to reclaim our own history and to celebrate its continuity and its achievements and to remember its leaders and everything that the old Labour Party and the trade unions were able to do. You have to remember, we're now talking 1997, that the Labour Party by then had been replaced by New Labour, and one of the things they wanted to do was to stop singing the red flag at the end of the Labour Party conference each year. So obviously, basically, people in the GMB were pretty riled up about this. So it made sense to, you know, put the thing in stone. Paul Kenny was very clear and agreed with Tommy that the Red Flag Monument was needed to set in stone the world-class historic achievements of the generations of manual workers' unions and the massive contribution that the history, to that history of rural workers from Ireland and elsewhere, and to the liberation and emancipation of the working classes. You've got to remember, in the gasworks, they were for 12-hour day, they were shoveling coal into retorts and then taking the coal out. For 12 hours, 6 days a week, they managed to get down to 8 hours, and yeah, so that was an emancipation and liberation from unremitting toil. Now, New Labour was turning its back on this history, and on the vital lessons that had been learned during the long-running and enduring campaign for economic and social justice. I don't think that we can be reminded often enough of one of the main themes in the Red Flag song, which is employer hostility to unions. And second, the rural background of the man who wrote it, and the ongoing role in human history of the move of the rural population to the cities. When we came to Crossachiel in 1998 to unveil the wonderful monument, I was asked to do an interview live on RT Radio, Lunchtime News, on that Sunday. Obviously, I was very pleased and proud of the monument and what it stood for. The young woman reporter asked me about the relevance to people in Ireland, contemporary Ireland, of unveiling a monument to a dead hero of a bygone age. I said that the monument was to mark a milestone in the international campaign for economic and social justice and the huge contribution of Irish migrant workers to it. I said that in 1997, there was probably 6 billion people in the world, and out of that 6 billion, maybe a billion, the lucky ones, had a good deal, and the rest had a very long way to go before prosperity reached them. I said that in the words of our national poet, W.B. Yeats, this world's more full of weeping than you can understand. And that was still true in 1997, as it had been when Yeats wrote the words. I said that the campaign was only in its early stages, and that what had been done in the UK and Ireland would have to be done again, would have to be done across the globe, and the monument marked an important milestone in the campaign. That answer neatly summarises the position, although in retrospect, I think I underestimated the impact of employer hostility in the UK and Ireland, and the extent to which the clock would be turned backwards. The Labour and trade union movement is a living movement dealing with the problems of today and tomorrow and drawing on the experience of the past. There are two aspects in particular about the current and future situations that I would like to focus on. The first is the growth across the world of export processing zones, and the second is the continuing ongoing movement of the rural populations into the cities. Both are impacting on our everyday lives today. About export processing zones, these were first developed as a way of promoting economic development. One of the very first in the world was at Shannon Airport, where exemption from duty and other incentives were used to get employers to locate there. Export processing zones were meant to be temporary, but they have become a permanent feature of the international trade system. In 1975, there were 79 export processing zones in 25 countries employing 800,000 people. By 1997, this had grown to 845 export processing zones in 93 countries employing 22.5 million people. In 2002, this had grown to 3,000 in 116 countries with 43 million people working. The last figure we have is for 2006, where we have 3,500 export processing zones in 130 countries employing 66 million people. The cocktail of entitlements and legal exemptions vary from zone to zone, but they include holidays from income tax and sales taxes, dedicated utilities like electricity and broadband, deregulation of labour laws, prohibition of trade unions and strikes, deregulation of environmental laws, access to cheap domestic and imported labour, exemption from import and export duties. The main thing to note is that the vast majority of the manufacturing units are owned and run by multinational corporations. If a strike breaks out in Zone A in, say, Morocco, the employer's immediate response is to lock out the striking workers and to move the contract to Zone B in, say, Honduras, which also owned by that same company, until the strike is put down. Now, we, in Ireland, of all places, we know what the impact of a lockout is, because it happened in Dublin, and it was devastating. And yeah, so basically, these workers haven't got a chance, not a chance. Literally, they're locked out, and the vast majority of people in the world don't know anything about them. The merchandise on sale across the developed world in the shops and online comes from these export processing zones. What we are talking about here is organised employer hostility to unions on a massive scale. When Jim Connell wrote The Red Flag, he couldn't have envisaged the sheer scale of this institutionalised employer hostility to unions. This is something that is barely acknowledged, let alone challenged. Export processing zones are the labour market equivalent to tax havens for the wealthy elite who don't want to pay their taxes. Neither can be tolerated. In the export processing zone, labour unrest is put down mainly by way of lockout. So the natural leaders of the workers, like John Burns, Will Thorne and Mary MacArthur, simply can't emerge, and economic and social development is utterly stifled. These workers need practical support to enable them to unionise and get collective bargaining. The low level of knowledge about this in the Western world has to change. BWTC has offered to work with a range of organisations to fund the development of wiki technology that will enable the export processing zones to be mapped so that there is transparency in the supply chain from the factory to the high street. The aim is to have an app so that consumers and others can see where the clothes and goods come from. It can be used at time of labour unrest in the export process zone to shine a light on the exploitation and the putting down of the new unions on the ground. Helping to liberate these 66 million plus workers is the next great challenge for the 160 million trade union members worldwide. The export processing zone are capital intensive places that cannot easily move, so that if the workers are unable to unionise, the step forward for the international campaign for economic and social justice will be huge. I know that the BWTC would welcome the support of the Jim Connell Society and of the Mead trade union movement to get this huge and ambitious project off the ground. The second aspect I would like to draw attention to is that the vast majority of the 66 million workers in the export processing zones in the 21st century are rural workers moving to the city for rural workers moving to the cities for work, like Jim Connell was in the 19th century. The movement from the rural areas to the city is not something new. It is ongoing and will be with us for the rest of this century. I would like to draw attention to a book by Doug Saunders, which is called The Arrival City, and it deals with this story. He has a chapter about 19th century London, which covers the time that Jim Connell left County Meath that I've already touched on. The move is always related to change in economics and the need for workers and their families to earn a living. He tells the story of two tenant farmers called Will and Lucy Luck, who were evicted from their cottage near Luton in 1874 in the final sweep of the Enclosure Act. They ended up in the arrival city that had spread outwards from Paddington Station in London, where both found work. He goes on to say that millions of people from across Britain were following the Lux path to London in what was, until the late 20th century, history's largest rural to urban migration. London was by far the largest city in the world, and almost at any time in the 19th century, at least 40% of its citizens were born outside the city. By 1901, the metropolis contained a startling 1.3 million rural rural arrivals. At least 50,000 a year arrived from the rural areas in the latter half of the 19th century. So Jim Connell was one of them, and he was not an exception, but the rule. Doug Saunders says that what will be remembered about the 21st century more than anything else, except maybe climate change, is of the great and final shift of the human population out of the rural agricultural life and into cities. We will end the 21st century as a wholly urban species. The numbers involved obviously are estimated because their estimates vary about population projections. So by definition, the numbers can only estimated. Much of the migration from the rural to urban areas will be like what has happened in China, in that people move inside the country. Yet in other areas, it will resemble the vast migrations from the rural Europe into America. Looking at Saunders' figures, worldwide, it looks likely to be between 10 and 15 million per year, each year, for the next century. Saunders says that the population of Europe, America, and China are not replacing themselves because of our low birth rate, and some of these rural workers will be absolutely essential to maintain our health and social services and other services. We also have to face the fact that many of the jobs there, where there will be labour shortages, will be in the lower skilled and the semi-skilled areas, like agriculture, transport, construction, catering and tourism. Maybe robots will be developed to do these jobs. If not, low-skilled and semi-skilled rural workers will be needed to fill them. The supply of rural workers from Central and Eastern Europe will dry up, as it has already done from the rest of rural Europe. Saunders says that Europe may face competition for these rural migrants from China and America. Saunders calls for us to face up to this continuing and ongoing movement, and also to face the fact that it is not new, and that we do have practical experience of dealing with it from our own history. Now, the subject itself is too big and too important for me to deal with properly in this lecture. I can only refer to it because of the links to Jim Connell. But suffice for me to say that I agree with Saunders about the ongoing movement and agree that it is not something new. And maybe the Jim Connell Society would like to plan a future Tommy Grimes lecture on this important topic, which relates directly to Jim Connell and the red flag and the ongoing rural to urban migration. I would say this. The Red Flag Monument is probably the only labour movement monument anywhere in the world dedicated to this rural to urban migration, linking it to the growth and victories of our movement. In stone, it says. This monument, in memory to Jim Connell, is dedicated to the millions of Irish immigrants who fought for economic and social justice and helped build the trade union movement worldwide. The song The Red Flag was inspired by the London Dock Strike in 1889 and the struggle to win the eight-hour day that same year. These significant events heralded the unionisation of unskilled workers in Britain and Ireland and their liberation from unrelenting toil. It actually says that on the monument. I will conclude this lecture by drawing what I see to be some important lessons from our 170 years of history. Now, these are my conclusions, and you feel free to disagree with them. The first and most important conclusion is that there is enduring support for the intergenerational campaign for economic and social justice, and that it is possible, with the right leadership, to draw on that support and to win battles and secure successful outcomes. Second, it is fatal to underestimate or discount in any way the ongoing, enduring and deep-rooted hostility of employers to trade unions. Jim Connell was raised in a very hierarchical and unequal society, and for him, the impact of, quote, the rich man's frown was real. And he saw the way that the unequal distribution of power did lead people to doff their caps, and others whose mind are fixed on self and players to put ahead of everything else their need to climb the greasy pole. The impact of the elite has not gone away, and there are powerful in society, forces in society that seeks to permanently undermine and sideline the trade union movement and to deny workers their fundamental right to combine and force collective bargaining on their employers. The gains of each generation are constantly under assault, and the changing nature of industry means that the trade union movement can easily get sidelined by these changes. My own personal view is that the institutions of the labour movement need to attach a far higher priority than they do to the insidious effects of employer hostility. Let me just take one example from our own area in the last year of the cinema workers in Brixton and other parts of London employed by a multinational Cineworld. Brave and courageous work by these cinema workers led to successful trade union organisation in six cinemas, an overwhelming majority of 300 the newly unionised workers for strike action for the London Living Wage and trade union recognition. In the course of the dispute, Cineworld sacked four of the lay leaders of the dispute. That happened last summer. The only legal remedy open to the union faced with this injustice is to take a claim to an employment tribunal for unfair dismissal for the trade union activists. This is grossly inadequate. So in other words, basically maybe March or April next year, they might maybe get an award of a few bob. Meanwhile, what we have here is the internationally recognised human rights of these four workers to combine and force their employer to bargain with them collectively, trampled upon with near total impunity. Understandably, this has affected the dispute, which is ongoing after 2 years. I am of the view that dealing with this employer hostility is the most important issue facing the future of the trade union movement. The near impunity, the current near impunity in the UK and Ireland has to end. The internationally tolerated impunity in the export crossing has to be brought to an end too. My remedy would be that it should become a criminal offence punishable by heavy fines and jail sentences for managers to trample on the human rights of workers to organise. Given that tool, unions can start to rebuild unions in the private sector and new industries, especially for the over 30% of the workforce in what used to be called the all manual workers' jobs. Third, we need to draw from our own history the ingredients of good leadership. The most important element in leadership is the right ideas and policies. Charisma, inspiration, and empathy are necessary but not sufficient. The best guide to theory is what has worked in practice. For example, my own personal view is that we can conclude from history that a labour movement that concentrates on correcting the basic flaws in capitalism is more likely to be successful in the campaign for economic and social justice and in promoting prosperity for its members than a labour movement that ignores the basic flaws, like New Labour did, or those that sought instead to overthrow capitalism, as per the Soviet Union. John Burns concluded that only the labour movement could correct the basic flaws in capitalism, which, if not corrected, lead to misery for all. First, capitalism cannot guarantee everybody a job, so a welfare state is absolutely essential. Second, capitalism left to itself tends to monopoly and excess, and gross excess, in wealth and income, so only nationalisation of the natural monopolies, robust competition law, and proper taxes on wealth and income are vital. Third, capitalism tends to boom and bust, and thus and this can't be avoided. The state has to be braced to mitigate the worst impacts and to stop recessions turning into depressions and maybe wars. I am of the view that a labour movement dedicated to correcting the flaws of capitalism, in addition to all our normal programmes to deepen democracy and entrench the rule of law, as well as promoting economic and social justice for everybody, regardless of race, creed, colour, nationality, gender, sexual orientation or ability, is the correct policy mix. I'm also of the view that it will enjoy widespread support electorally. The great advantage of this programme is that its direction doesn't have to change as the labour movement seeks to deal with all the contemporary challenges that we face. Just as important, because it is a continuous campaign, it is essential that we follow the right strategy to win our aims. What this was spelt out by General Giap, who was the commander of the Vietnamese army that over a very, very long period defeated the French army and subsequently the US army. 20 years after the fall of Saigon, he was asked what his strategy had been. And he said he had followed the only strategy that can be followed for a long and continuous campaign, and that is all fronts at all times. So the labor movement has to be active on every front, be it political, industrial, social, legal, economic, cultural, domestic and international, and give a priority at different times to different fronts. Could I conclude by suggesting to the Jim Connell Society that it draw on the what is written on the Red Flag Monument on the, as the subject for future Tommy Graham's memorial lectures? I think it would be good to have a lecture on all aspects of the rural migration from County Meath that took place in the second half of the 19th century, that's covered in chapter 22 of the book I mentioned earlier. And I think Raymond Crotty's work on the political implication of this transfer of land ownership is worthy of further study. And I think that a future lecture could possibly cover the tangled history of Britain and Ireland, as covered by Norman Davies in his History of the Isles. I wish that we had been taught that in schools. And I already suggested something on the arrival city. I will finish on this last point. The question asked by the young woman reporter from RTE about the relevance of the monument today and into the future is a key one, and we have an answer of great relevance to the 21st century. Rural migration into the cities began in earnest in the second half of the 19th century. The story told by the monument is how that migration added a vital contribution to the emerging and world-class successes of our movement. The Red Flag Monument specifically links the successes of our movement then and since to the contribution from this first wave of rural workers moving into the cities. We are still in the middle of an ongoing movement of rural workers into the cities, which will continue for the rest of this century. The Red Flag Monument, drawn from our documented and practical history, demonstrates that the labour movement links to this ongoing migration is a winning hand for the movement and society. As the song says, it gives hope of peace at last, the banner bright, the symbol plain of human right and human pain. This very positive and relevant lesson for one of the biggest issues that we face in Ireland today and worldwide and into the future is not based on theory, but on hard practical experience. Societies that want to live in harmony simply cannot afford to indulge or tolerate prior hostility. The red flag should guide public policy. As the song concludes, when head uncovered, swear we all, to bear it onwards till we fall, come dungeons dark or gallows grim, this song shall be our parting hymn. Thank you very much.
Steve, another one.
So the great Irish tradition is I get the stew. So if you'd like to make great before you change it all,